We have at least one more season with Edmonton. This might be the last run. And in a way, I kind of hope it is. We've won, what, 3 out of the last 4 Stanley Cups? This team deserves one more opportunity to win. Unlike with the Anaheim, we've already had some classic players with Jimmy Hart and Andrew Andrews probably leading the way on that front. Yes, I'm still going to be looking over and paying attention to the Bruins game for the majority of this, but still, you get it. You know the deal. Whether or not this team can win our 4th cup in 5 years, I don't know. More over-the-top, ridiculous trades might be necessary, but damn it, we have to go for it. Like I said, if this is our last run, so be it. It's either the dynasty continues, or after 3 cups in 4 years, we have to take a little bit of a step back and retool, of course, so we won't really be here for that, but still. Or it might be. I don't know. We have 5 first-round picks heading into the new year, too. So, that's always good. It's not as if this team isn't set up well enough for the future. I mean, it's pretty ridiculous. It's pretty ridiculous how well-equipped this team is right now. So, we're going to see what we can do. We're going to see if there is one more cup on the horizon for these retooled Oilers. We shall see. Is cap off? It is not. We have played this whole time with the salary cap on. The entire time. Well, Miss Davis, and Keith. Those were... It sucks. With the Anaheim run, like I said, I mentioned it last night and mentioned it kind of now. You know, I'm not wanting to burn myself out on an NHL franchise. Anaheim was going way too similarly to Edmonton, and there wasn't as much of a challenge because, again, we were making the playoffs right out of the gates. At least with this, we missed the playoffs for a couple of years before it ended up getting over-the-top ridiculous. And then, of course, we won 3 cups in a row. So, I'm intrigued to see if we can get one more. But with Anaheim, I mean, Carter was looking like he was going to be a beast. You had Davis, you had Keith. There's some good names to, you know, there's some good names to remember. I think that's what a lot of people need to remember, though, too, is that Edmonton and Anaheim, temporary stuff, right? Just temporary stuff. They were never meant to be 30-plus episodes, you know, just temporary. Long form, temporary, get a couple of seasons done, see how it goes kind of deal. So, you know, an Oilers team with a bunch of new tools. Except there aren't enough tools on the current team. Da-da-da. Sorry. Dirt biker, what's going on? What's happening? Oh, boy. Yeah, Minecraft cap is on. Kidding. What's going on as well? We're keeping an eye on the Bruins-Sharks game. Hoping to win one more cup. To keep this dynasty alive. And I'm probably finishing Mafia 2 tonight. Which is going to be great. Which is going to be great, because I think after last night, too, we're done with Resident Evil. which is unfortunate, but that is what it is. Maybe we revisit that at a different time. Bakersfield underperforming, but we're up to 11-2-3 to start the year. Not bad. If you win another one, you'll really be like the 80s Oilers, because at this point, everyone by not getting 4 in a row. Yeah. Elon, that's a really good comparison. That's a really good comparison. That's a, God, dare I say the name, Steve Smith? Dare I say the name Steve Smith? That poor guy. So who was the Steve Smith of our series against the Blues last year? That's the real question. That is the real question. Oh, boy. Kofstra, the game between San Jose and Boston's been a bit scrappy ever since the Bruins were up 3-0, especially because of Evander Kane. That's what Evander Kane does. Steve Smith, born in Scotland. Indeed, he was. It's one of my favorite fun facts. Oilers disappointing even when successful. That's the thing, though. If the Oilers were to turn their team into a dynasty again with McDavid at the helm, and they win 3 straight cups but lose the 4th, they would probably complain just as much as they would now. At least certain members of the Oilers fan base would. But that's how it goes. night, what's going on? Jones better bail out my fantasy team. Good luck with that. Varlamov got a shutout. What the fuck is this season? Varlamov's not that bad when he's on his game. So, I wouldn't say that's all that surprising. At least not as surprising as this team failing as much as we have this month. It's my birthday today, but I thought I should stop by for a bit. What a guy. What a guy. Oh, I already used the confetti cannon. Why couldn't your birthday have been yesterday? I already cleaned up all the confetti. Damn it. That would have been the perfect occasion. Oh, God. All right. What do you get for a birthday gift then? Damn it. Number one, that's dedication. Will Erik Karlsson resign with the Sharks? I'm going to say no, because I like fun. Although I'd like to see the Sharks finally win something. But I'm going to say no. Oh, God. What's a good birthday meme? What's a good birthday meme that's not going to get me copyrighted on YouTube? Oh, goodness. I'm not singing anything, so don't ask. Oh, boy. Oh, boy. I got nothing for you. How about a trombone?
Did you catch any of the World Cup Friday?
We need more cannons. We do. They're $3 a pop, you see, because they're cannons. I really should just buy them in bulk. I really should. Why have the Boston commentators spend the entire game complaining about a non-goal, even when up 3-0? Because there's an argument that it should have been a goal, and because that's what commentary teams do. Alex Kovanov, was he ours? There's no way he was. Drafted by Minnesota. So hold on here, Gooby. So you mean to tell me that if you, working for the network that the Bruins broadcasted on, if there's a feeling that they may have been screwed out of getting a goal, or if there's a feeling that, you know, there was a weird call, and then all of a sudden, the game gets close, that you're not gonna take the side of like, we're getting shafted. Of course you are. You're appealing to the regional audience. That's how it works. I'm so sick and tired of people being like, this commentary group is biased. No shit. They're supposed to be. I don't understand. It was objectively not over the line. That's just like your opinion, man. Ha, you see? Gotcha. Checkmate. Rob was really solid tonight. I kept an eye on it. Meh. Tim and Sid, Jay and Dan, fight me. I really like Tim and Sid, too. I only really get to watch of their show what they post up on the Sportsnet YouTube channel, but I really like them as well. So. They were complaining when it was 3-0 10 minutes in. Of course they were! They're supposed to! Jesus! View commentary teams as propaganda for the team that they are commentating for. Alright? If it's my job to commentate for the Bruins, I'm not gonna be objective. I'm gonna be the biggest biased homer there. Everyone's fucking us and screwing us. It's a conspiracy. Like, that's what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to appeal to the fans of that team. Even if it's the worst. Canucks commentary isn't biased. I guarantee you some people think they are. Guarantee. If an Oilers fan watches Canucks commentary, they're gonna say that they're biased. That's how it works, man. That's how commentary teams work. Unless we're talking about Joe Buck, in which case he's just an idiot. I'm kidding, I don't mind Joe Buck. Or do I? Is he terrible? I don't know. Opinions. That's the Boston way. That's the every way. Have you listened to, like, Florida Panthers commentary? Come on now. Some teams are just more biased than others. And that's fine. I'm sorry, I do not understand why people have ever complained about the commentary team that does every game for the New Jersey Nets, the Brooklyn Nets, whatever the fuck, they're biased for their team. You don't fucking say. I fucking love me some Rick Janneret. Tell me this clip isn't him being biased and over the top in favor of the Sabres. Oh, that's not bias. That's just a good call. Fuck you. That is over the top, hyping up your team more than anything. We have found Toogie's trigger. This is not a trigger. This is me slapping people down. Back down to reality where they belong. Biased, Rick Janaret. Still love you. Biased. And if you disagree...
Bag skate, pussies.
That's what you deserve. That's what you deserve. All right? That's what happens. So quit being dumb. Anyway, Kirill Kaprizov. People wanted me to trade him. Glad I didn't. Glad I didn't. What you get from a local broadcast when you get biased national commentary, then you have an issue. I agree. I completely agree. If it's an NBC, like if Doc Emmerich, you know, it's like if Doc Emmerich's being a little bit biased towards one team, that's kind of a problem. If it's New Jersey, I understand because he worked for the Devils for a long time. Alpha Slav. Love you. Thank you for that beautiful 7 month. But, you know, it is what it is. John Shorthouse is in no way biased. He is. Because I just said he is, so deal with it. And if I say someone's biased, it must be true, right? Aha! Checkmate! Turned your logic around on you. Anyway, how's Besser doing? Not bad, but not killing it. Whoever codes NHL games are either terrible at their job or can't be bothered to do it. Maybe. Brock, you're letting me down here, buddy. That is not $11 million a year performance worthy. The two prior years were. I'm not overly happy with one Brock Besser right now. Change him back to a playmaker. Joe Bowen isn't biased, JK. There you go. What are Connor's career numbers at this point? We'll check soon. Maybe. I just don't want to add everything up. Getting a Bees jersey soon. I can't decide between Rask, Pasta, and Krug. Rask is more of a middle finger to some people. Pasta's the obvious choice. So I say go with Torrey Krug. Because there are not enough Torrey Krug jerseys out there in the world. So there you go. That is my suggestion. It's stupid that Nesson's the international broadcast for any game involving the Bruins. It's stupid that any... Well, I mean, here's the thing, though. Someone has to carry the international side of it. So, that's what you get. Deal with it, enjoy it, love it. And if you can't...
Shit my nuts! Ah, fuck you, fuckstick!
There we go. That's the proper response. Do I want to make a trade at the deadline is the question. I'm doing the broadcast of football. Our team's biased towards the school we cover. During basketball season, our commentary team calls the game. Considering we don't cover just one team. There you go. Holy shit. Coster speaking the truth. Not that I'm surprised. I'm just saying. It's like, wait a minute. You mean that's how it works? Shocker. I mean, come on. Of course that's how it works. Oh, boy. So Tomek's killing it. Wallstead's letting us down. Objectively speaking, who's my favorite commentary team in the NHL? I gotta be honest. I would probably agree that he would be a little bit unbearable if he wasn't a Bruins fan. He is a Bruins fan, let's be honest. I don't mind Jack Edwards because he's fucking hilarious. I don't care what anybody says. He's fucking hilarious. But, God, I don't hate Doc Emmerich either. I gotta look at the commentary team for everybody, really. Here's the problem, though. I don't get to listen to a ton of other commentary teams, obviously. I mean, unless you're, you know, sitting there watching the local coverage, right? But I don't hate Jack and Andy. I don't do it. I don't hate them. Sorry. I still love me some Rick Janaret. I've heard a bit of John Forslund, who does Carolinas. Oh boy, there's a lot of others though that I haven't heard, and then you'll be like, oh, I'm gonna name this commentary team that does my local coverage, and it's like, ah, cool. Apparently there's some dude named Jiggs McDonald who does the commentary for the Islanders. That's pretty sweet. Sam Rosen and Kenny Albert aren't that bad either, by the way. Who else? I'm scrolling through the lovely list. Eh, whatever. We're fine. It's cool. Don't worry about it. You get the point. Anyway. Wallstead, I need to decide if this is our final season for sure. Guess who set up their OBS today? A lot of people, I'm guessing, because streaming's the hot thing to do. So, Wallstead, you weren't the problems. You weren't the problems? You weren't the problem. The problems we had in the playoffs weren't solely down to you. However. There might be. Oh, God, come on, game. Your double button presses. There might be room for a reunion. If this is the last hurrah, there might be room for a reunion. He's getting paid quite a bit by San Jose. And we could completely botch this. Check Twitter, please. No. Because I won't do what you tell me. Thatcher, how are you doing this year? Yeah, you're doing well, aren't you? Damn. Dan, what's going on? What's happening? Golino! Golino! With that beautiful prime sub. I don't understand why people complain about the Bruins cast when they're obviously going to be home. Exactly. And San Jose just scored again. Joe Thornton breaking my heart. Again. Oh, Demko. You know what? I think this is our last hurrah. I think this season is our last hurrah. We have a ridiculous team, and it's just going to be more and more competition. The streak is over. We're just going for one more. It'd be a terrible idea to trade Wallstead. But still. Still. This is it. I'm gonna call it here. This is our last season. This is the last hurrah. 30 games above 500. We need better goaltending. We do! Wallstead has a 908 this season. I mean, come on. We do need better goaltending. This is gonna be our final year. We might screw around and maybe let the AI destroy the team a little bit, maybe not, because I gotta be honest, I'm finding that a little bit boring. But Demko won us those three cups. We lose. It wasn't Wallstead's fault. But I think we're bringing Demko back. I think we're bringing Demko back for one more run. Unfortunately, the Sharks can't retain any salary. So that would be a very rough contract. I don't even know if we'd have to, we probably wouldn't even have to give up anything. It's going to be kind of close. It's going to be San Jose. You got to play them in the playoffs. There's a good chance of that. Trust me, I know that that's a risk. The deal is one for one. I would never do that trade. I would never do that trade if it wasn't our last season. We're going for one more. Demko, welcome back. Win one more for us on the way out. John Klingberg, unfortunately, has dropped two overall points as well. I think he's on the way out, too. Voros has done all right. Klingberg's not playing that badly. Jesus Christ, that top pairing. Tough call of how crazy I want to go with this defense, but again, we're going all in. I'm not going to go overly unrealistic in terms of like, I'm going to use all my picks to get all these players, but I do know what I want to do. You technically downgraded. Well, the good thing is technical downgrades don't mean a damn thing, so it's cool. It's fine. The question is... I'm going to play this as if I was continuing on, with the exception, of course, of that Demko swap. Am I ready for Liverpool-Bayern? I'm not. Nervous as hell for that game tomorrow. Nervous as hell. We want overly realistic. Well, it's a good thing for me to mention that I don't care what you want. I don't. Because oftentimes, what you want might not line up with what's interesting to me. And if it's not interesting to me, I'm gonna be bored as fuck, and it's not gonna be fun for anybody. Okay? Anyway. Oh, goodness gracious. We need another defenseman. AJ, no. Again, for anybody that missed it, it's the last time I'm saying it, and if it's asked again, I'm just not going to answer you. I'm going to be taking a break from streaming NHL franchise for a couple of weeks. I don't know what's coming up next, when it's coming, don't know, don't ask, don't need suggestions. We'll get there. When we get there, the end of it. How do you feel about Boston playing Toronto in the first round? Not looking forward to it because the Leafs are going to beat them eventually, but whether or not this is the year, who knows? Who knows? Anyway. We need to find a replacement for Klingberg, potentially. But I'm only going to do it if there's someone who's cheap enough to pick up. Enjoy the break. It's just a break from this, though. I'm still going to be streaming. I just don't know what I'm going to be streaming next. And again, not looking for suggestions either. I'll figure it out. But that's kind of what I do. It's what I've always done. It's like I'll play the shit out of something and then step away from it for a while. It's how it works. Ian Mitchell, you are doing terribly. You should be a half decent. You should be a half decent option, though. You're not that good. Please tell me there's somebody better on the market than Ian Mitchell. I don't need comments about what's happening in the Bruins game. I know, it's on the TV. It's fine. I got it covered. I'm paying attention. Don't worry. I might miss something, but it's there. Their last power play was a complete waste, so I'm not too excited. Maybe Return of the Walking Dead. Maybe I do nothing, AJ! Jesus! I just said I don't want and I'm not taking suggestions on, hey, you could do this, you could do that, and you keep throwing suggestions my way. I'm trying to be nice and you're pushing buttons. I'm not getting agitated over it, but damn. Use them ears, man. If I don't get to The Walking Dead now, I'll get to it in a couple of weeks before the season finale comes out. You see, that's why I'm saying I will get to stuff eventually. I just don't know what's next. So shush. Anyway. Lunkfist, hello. Not too bad. And Brady Shea, maybe. I thought you meant NHL suggestions. No, I mean suggestions in general. It's not me being a dick, but I will stream what I want to stream when I want to stream it. If that is not interesting to you, that's okay. It's the internet. I'm not literally being like, if you don't want to watch what I do, go watch someone else. But I'm saying, you know, it's okay. If I do something, and if a game that I'm playing does not interest you, it's cool. It's all good. I don't expect every single person who likes what I do to like every aspect of what I do. You know? There you go. Dookie's on a heater tonight. Not quite. Turtle, what's going on, man? How are you tonight? Dunn and Perunovic are both terrible. Both terrible. Oh, San Jose might have just scored. Okay, what just happened? Jesus Christ. There's no way they just called that a goal, right? There's no way that's going to stand as a goal. There's no way. I can only imagine how much Jack Edwards is freaking out right now because of the no call earlier. Yeah, it already got called back. That was interesting. Oh, let's see. Is there anybody? Okay, so we don't have the best options in terms of defensive pickups. We have Dunn, Perunovic. Who else was there? It was Dunn, Perunovic, the duo in New York, and Ian Mitchell. So, let's see. So, Shea and Lundqvist are both doing pretty well this year. And then what about The duo in St. Louis. I know it's a penalty shot. I'm looking. I can see. Stop it with the in-chat play-by-play. Damn it. Ugh. Maybe I am getting agitated because I keep having to repeat myself tonight. Jesus. Ugh. And Couture scores and the Bruins have blown a lead. Hmm. Good. Good. That's fun. Well, let's see if Sinski hit me up on Twitter yet. He probably has. I would assume. He hasn't yet. Shocking. Shocking. It'll happen, though. Somewhere Sinski's cheering. Oh, yeah, he will. He's going to hit me up on Twitter any second now. I'm looking forward to it. That's why I never even, like, kind of hint, hint, wink, wink, nudge, nudge. Hey, my team's beating yours. You know? Always comes back to haunt you. So, Dunn and Perunovic have both been terrible this season. And let's see. Whoa, EA, what the fuck? Hello? Okay, there we go. It's really weird. The trigger wasn't working there for a second. It's still... What the fuck? I don't even know what's going on anymore. Hmm. I don't know how Lundqvist has the point total that he does. Because he has no passing. It's unbelievable. Your arrogance did this to us. Well, you know. Well, you know. Drink more high sugar lemonade and iced tea product. I will. I will. I'll drink more of it than I should. Because I already do. Sinski still hasn't hit me up on Twitter. I'm waiting for it. It might be a subtweet. It might be a subtweet. It could happen. Let's see. I just realized they have Yossi on the block, too, but I'm not really interested. Hmm. Do I want to stick with the same defense? We've already brought Thatcher back for one more run. Klingberg and Avoros haven't been that bad, though. Of course, Klingberg's on a miracle contract. It's pretty nice. Hmm. I feel like we have to make that move, though. Let's see. Shea has 1 year left, huh? What if we go for Shea and Lundqvist? Cap-wise, it's looking half-decent, too. If anybody on the block, just to add extra value. Oh, yeah, I'm sure you want all of our best players. That's not going to happen. Alright, so this might be where the draft picks come into play. Especially because I'm going to need them to retain on Brady Shea. Where's the most successful team done? Rebuilding Hockey Town's probably still... I mean, that's still the gold standard of successful, successful series for me. Let's see, we can give up Kiprusoff here. So Kiprusoff in a first... We bring in some defensive help. Have a little bit of an insurance policy as well. I'm going to give up Klingberg in this too. Going to give up Klingberg. He's regressing. He's had a good season this year. But I'm going to give him up too. Oh boy. Alright, let's see. So just a safety net this a little bit, just in case. Yeah, I had a feeling it would go through if it wasn't for the salary. Come on, New York, do it. Thank you. I'll take it. I will take it. So Klingberg hasn't been bad, but he's regressing. We got Werenski, Jones, Makar, Andrzejczuk, Shea, Lundqvist, Voros will be sent down. Although apparently that would put us over the cap. By sending someone down, we're going to be over the cap. Figure that one out. Even though we have $4 million in cap space... As you can see in the bottom left-hand corner. I don't know. I don't know. Don't ask me to explain that one. Savoros, hate to tell you, but you get to sit there. You'll be a black ace for the playoffs. Congratulations. Congratulations. I think we might go Andrzejczuk, Makar. And then the former Ranger pairing will be the third pair. Demko's back, man. One more season. one more season. Just because I'm not, again, not going to be like, I've lost interest in this. I've just, you know, I'm feeling the impending burnout of franchise, and, you know, it'll be fine. So, let's see. And offensively, we're still fine for the most part. It's just the Besser's not producing like he could be. But you have 16 points there. I think we're good. Bump up the defense. Bring back a 3-time Stanley Cup champion in Thatcher Demko. We're good to go. You didn't sense the one with tremendous back problems. Yeah, I knew I forgot to. But I'm like, I just don't fucking care. That was my honest opinion. That was my honest opinion with that Mafia video, where it's like, okay, right as it was done uploading, I'm like, fuck, I forgot to censor it. Do I want to sit there and wait for it to re-render and re-upload? Or do I just want to see what happens and see if I get demonetized? We'll find out, won't we? It is what it is. I don't know, I might re-upload a censored version, I don't fucking know. We'll see. Haven't gotten anything, haven't gotten any warning about it yet, so we'll see. We'll see. I might, like I said, I might re-edit that, we'll see. Time will tell. Smondays, huh? Thank you for the follow. The impending burnout of chat trying to tell you how to franchise. Eh. I don't listen to him anyway. Thoughts on ECW? A product of its time that doesn't hold up well at all. In my opinion, at least. At least most aspects of it. So, yeah. Better to be remembered as opposed to revisited, I'd probably say. So, that's my opinion. And I'm sticking to it. Oh, boy. Nothing from Sinski yet, man. Nothing. I'm looking forward to it, though. It's got to happen, right? Did I say CZW is the stupidest thing out there? Yes, but if people enjoy it, then let the people enjoy it. It's always my opinion of it. Joel Gertner. Yeah, pretty much. In terms of not aging well. That's one of them. But yeah, AJ, I don't know. My opinion of the more over-the-top hardcore wrestling is like, eh, people enjoy it, fuck it. Sinski's probably sleep-ski? Probably not. At 9 p.m. ski? On the West Coast ski? I wouldn't think so. Then again, he does work that California 9-to-5. We have won 60 games this season. We still have a couple of days to sim before everyone's caught up. But, and we still have one more day. Wow. Our season ended early. 125 points. Another conference title in the bag, at least in the regular season. The question is, have we won the President's Trophy outright? Yes, we have. By a decent margin. 11 points over Tampa. San Jose finished in second. So, that's scary. But the good thing is, we should be moving. I hope to God we're moving to the central portion of the bracket. We're not! We are on a collision course with San Jose, more than likely. Maybe. Possibly. Actually. Yeah, we stay here. So Winnipeg would play Vegas, we're playing Calgary. Okay. Fun. Winnipeg, Colorado, Dallas, there. The Atlantic is Tampa, Boston, Toronto, Buffalo, and Ottawa. Philly, New Jersey, and Columbus. We are on that collision course. Oh, with Jesper Wallstedt and the San Jose Sharks. We averaged nearly 4 goals a game at 3.82. Goals against was at a 2.3, which was the second lowest. Tied for the second lowest with Tampa. So, that's the first time in a long time our goals against average has been above a 2. Power play at 27.7%. Best in the league. I know the glitch is going on. And the penalty kill was decent. Top 5. 83.3%. Oh, you never get a break. For what? Define I never get a break in terms of what? That's my question. AJ, I agree, but I also disagree, and then again, if someone enjoys it, screw it. Why not? Let them eat cake. That's my response. Man, okay. I don't know what to feel heading into the playoffs. McDavid and Kaprizov both hit 90. Brock Besser only 75 points. He had an amazing first two seasons here, including a playoff run with us where he nearly won the Conn Smythe. Only got topped by McDavid in terms of points. Was good in the playoffs last year too, but 75 points this year. I am a little bit concerned about one Brock Besser. Double A hit 63, Jimmy Hart 58, good old Omelette at a 55. Asham 46, 41 from Marlowe, Fox, Vorobiev, Kallio, Kuhlman. Not too bad. Everyone at least broke 20. Only 75 points. He's getting paid $11 million a season. I can say only 75 points. Especially when you're playing with Connor McDavid and Kirill Kaprizov. Only 75 points is a very fair assessment. A very fair assessment. Jones with 62 points. Werenski with 53. Makar 45. Lundqvist 42. Of course, Andrzejczyk, who was here all year, with 19. And goaltending-wise, Demko finished the season with a 927. Tomek, again, proves to be an amazing backup. Not bad at all. Not bad at all. Robert Razor, that's what I'm saying, though, is certain aspects of ECW still hold up. A lot of it doesn't. But that's okay. That's okay. God, oh, wow. So McDavid and Kaprizov actually led the league in points. The scoring was down in general, which is kind of upsetting, if not very upsetting. I guess Besser's off the hook a little bit. Highest point total I've seen this year. I'm not sure. Probably something in the Vegas series. That I know I've seen people on Twitter be like, my God, this guy hit 120 points or something like that. So, but probably a point total from the Vegas series. Because we had a ridiculous set of seasons there. But breaking 100 is a little bit rare. Let's see. Oh, nope, hold on. Goal scoring king might have been Kaprizov. Or not. Pavel Dorofeev. Let's see. Four defensemen. Noah Delamont, Thomas Chabot. Two defensemen I probably should have gone for at one point and did not. For the rookies, Pascal Lefebvre. It's not Lefebvre, is it? Is it Lefebvre? Lefebvre? I don't fucking remember. Who cares? Vorobiev, you did okay, though. And in terms of goaltending, Wallstedt ended up being the winningest goaltender, which isn't surprising. He finished the year with a 919. Demko was the second highest among starting goalies in terms of save percentage. Actually, the third, because Michael DiPietro killed it. Yikes. Yikes. Razor, take it easy. We'll catch you later. Let's get the confirmation that we're taking on Calgary in the playoffs. We have one more chance. Again, I didn't want to depart too much from the plan that we were on, with the exception of bringing back Demko for one more run. It's the Battle of Alberta in the first round. And we desperately want to win one more cup. Oh my God, please. That was so weird. Goodrow at 33, still there. Monahan, Rick Mele, who was the number one pick, wasn't he? He was not. He was very much not. Very much not. Jonathan Dahlin, Lindholm, Chase Tennell, a former Oiler. How did he do since we got rid of him? That sounds about right. He's had it rough. Dubé, Deneau, Arezzo, who do you have on defense? We should probably win this series. Just gonna say that now. We should probably win this series. Mackenzie, weren't you the goaltender in St. Louis that kicked us out of the playoffs last year? Why do I feel like he was in St. Louis last year? I feel like he was in St. Louis last year. He might have been. All right. Let's do this. I don't really think we have too much to change about the team. Again, we had won three straight cups. We lost in the conference final last year to St. Louis. One more run. One more attempt. My god, some of the ratings on this team too. In fairness, the team is still stacked enough that we could just keep going. We really could. I said one more run, but again, in case I renege on that and want to keep going, the only real change is that, you know, I brought back Demko. Because I kind of lost faith in the alternative. We'll see. We shall see. Can we get 4 cups in 5 years? The series against Calgary begins now. 20 more wins than them in the regular season, too. See what happens. First period of game one, it's a goal apiece. Jimmy Hart and Tennell. Second period, it's another goal apiece effort. Cale Makar and Sean Monahan. Quick sim of the third period. And we take game one. Barely. Connor McDavid scores the winner with 2:34 left. We take game one by the score of 4-3. A little bit of a concerning start for Thatcher Demko in the defense. But I'll take it. Some players went 3-3 overtime to be 10 minutes long. It should be fucking 20 minutes long. 10 minutes will be fine, though, because odds are it's never going to go 10 minutes. But yeah, it'd be nice to see the shootout leave the game. It would be nice. It would be nice. Hugh Moore 3-on-3. Hard taco with the only known opinion of a human. Weird phrasing on that, but the only person I've ever seen be like, oh god, more 3-on-3 overtime. Who wants that? Everybody but you, apparently. First period of game two. Good start, Callio and Fox. Second period is scoreless. Quick sim of the third. And it's a 3-0 victory. Jimmy Hart with the other goal. Thatcher Demko returns to form with a 39-save shutout. We take the first two games here at home against the Flames. Make hockey 3-on-3 instead of 5-on-5. That'd be sick. Full time! Thoughts on the Hurricanes, Mimi, Don Cherry, and the merch. Very smart. That is a Jake Paul level of pushing merch right there. You know, without the clip art. Third game of this series, we head to Calgary. Let's see how this goes down. First period, we have the 1-0 lead, Vorobyev. Second period, 2-0 lead, Connor McDavid. Third period, it is a 3-0 series lead. McDavid and Besser both score. Lindholm ruins the shutout with 2 minutes left. But we have a 3-0 series lead here on Calgary. 3-point game for Brock Besser. That is the type of performance that we need. Overtime should be one player from each team. No goalies. They should play post. The crossbar challenge. First person to hit the crossbar from center ice wins. Calvin DeHaan tweeted the video of Don Cherry piano. That's amazing. Actually, I think I saw that. Game four. Can we sweep the Flames? First period. Calgary gets the opening goal. It's Tennell. Second period. We tie it. Kirill Kaprizov. Have we swept the Calgary Flames? Yes, we have. Omelette, Kuhlman, and Callio. Not a bad way to start this playoff run. With a sweep of the Flames, 26 saves for Demko, 2-point night for Callio, and we are good to go. 5 points in 4 games for McDavid, and now we await whoever the hell we're going to run up against in the second series, which is very, very nerve-wracking. Because it's guaranteed to be a difficult game no matter what. It's going to be San Jose or Vancouver. It's either going to be Wallstead, or it's going to be Michael DiPietro, who was the Vezina winner this season. There's no way that he won't be. Who's it going to be? It's going to be Vancouver. We have dominated the Canucks for years at this point. It's Colorado and Vegas as opposed to St. Louis in the second round, in the other second round matchup. Can we get past Vancouver one more time? Joe Thornton in the box for San Jose to start the third period. For the Canucks. We should win this. It's well-rounded, but between Pettersson, Aho, Horvat, we should win this. Defensively, they're still stacked, of course. It's the same six that have been there for a while, featuring Morgan and Mike Riley. And then goaltending-wise, it's DiPietro. who says you need a high poise rating to do well, right? Especially, too, after I was told that it doesn't really mean all that much within the context of the sim. It's just, it's a minor modifier, is what I've been told, basically. Let's go. No changes to our team. I'll jump into the calendar sim. That's fine, too. Game one against the Canucks. We're back in the second round. We have made it to the conference final for the past 4 years in a row. Can we make it five? First period of game one. Vancouver has the opening goal, Bo Horvat. Second period, nice little comeback, McDavid and the rookie Vorobiev. Third period, and the Canucks take game one. Dvorak ties it, Aho wins it. 3-2 final for the Canucks. They take game one and hand us our first loss of the postseason. DiPietro with a strong game, and Bo Horvat does it again. He has been, just a dominant scorer for them in every single series we've played against them, even though we've always come up on the winning end of it. First period of game two. Canucks get the opening goal again with 7 seconds left. Sven Bershky. Second period. We get a goal back, but not before Ryan Donato made a 2-1. Third period. Vancouver has a 2-0 series lead on the Oilers. Bershky and Donato. We thought the dynasty might have ended last year. And if it didn't then, it's looking like it might now. Outscored 7-3 over the course of the first two games. McDavid's still at a point a game. I can't say I'm overly happy with it though. Let's take a look. Demko's still doing well. He struggled to start this series, however. Defensively, our dominant top pairing is struggling to a major extent. Werenski Jones were so damn good in the regular season. Plus 56 for Werenski Jones at a 58. They are getting absolutely shelled. I'm going to go Shea Jones, Andrzejczyk, Makar, Werenski, Lundqvist. I trust Seth Jones on that top pairing more than Werenski. Let's take a look here at the fourth line. Knucklehead, what's up, buddy? Reese Fox, 4 points, 1 point for Kuhlman. Is there anybody else? Marlowe's struggling. He's going to go down. 3 points, 4 points for Kallio. Again, 4 points for Fox. Yeah, that's a problem. That is a problem. We have some players who just aren't getting it done. And that is a massive, massive issue. Let's see. We have Kallio probably stay on the third line. Kaprizov's not getting it done either. Yes, Knucklehead I have, but again, it's going to take a while for me to get anything set up. Which I've said that before, so stop asking about it. Let's see. Andrews will run center on the fourth line, which wasn't a part of the plan, but I'm not going to reward people who haven't been performing at a high level. So between Kallio and Hart, I gotta be honest, Jimmy, you're getting bumped down. Let's see, Ouellette. 5 points, 4 points, 5 points. Renee to the top line. Kaprizov down to the third line. Jimmy, you get bumped back up by default. Congratulations. Not going to reward people with ice time if they're not going to make the most of it. Asham's better defensively, so he will stay at center. Although, yeah, it's fine. And let's see. Let's go with... Yeah, McDavid will stay at center. Who wants to be on that right-hand side? Probably Hart. Although Hart's the best center. It'll be Kallio, Hart, Fox as the second line, which is not what I've expected. So it's fine. Why do you act like you've been repeating the same thing for hours? So privileged. Well, you know, I'm sorry. I can't help it. I'm just a massive dick. Because, you know, the people who have asked about something tonight might not have been here when you mentioned it earlier, or yesterday, or the day before, or the day before. You know. It's all good. It doesn't bother me. I try not to sound like a dick when I sit there and be like, hey, I've talked about this a lot already, you know? And then people are like, hey, but what about this? It's like, I just talked about it, man. I talked about it the day before. It's rough. Oh, God. But, you know, I'm sorry. I can't help it. I'm just a massive douche. First period of game three. Can we please get back into this series, or are we done here, Edmonton? What do you think? In the first period, scoreless. Second period, we got the goal, Brock Besser. Quick sim of the third period. We're still alive. Ouellette, Besser, and the mouth of the South. 4-1 final. And as per usual, line scrambling seems to result in some sort of boost for at least one game. Brock Besser, a 3-point night. Demko with 30 saves. We're good to go. Elimination Chamber was a lot of fun to watch. The main event itself was. Now, in my one fantasy booking scenario, I still would have preferred Kofi to win, right? And then, like, Brian cheats on SmackDown, but maybe he doesn't win the title. And then a fast lane, you get the New Day against Brian, Rowan, and whoever the fuck. And if Brian wins, he gets a rematch at Mania, and then he wins, and then it's Kofi walking into Mania as champion, and he drops the belt back to Brian, and everything's back to normal. But, you know, or Bryan can win too. It was the one time they got me to be like, I'm going to root against Daniel Bryan. And then I was upset that he lost, which is great. But still, if you're ever going to have Kofi Kingston win the WWE title, it should have been on Sunday. And then Raw tonight was a bit meh, as we've discussed. But you weren't here, so that's okay. I forgive you. First period of game four. Ooh. Second period. Hey, Brock again. Deja vu. Deja vu. Third period, do we have a tied series? Fucking double overtime, really? Alright, don't blink. You might miss it. It'll probably end within 5 seconds. If Vancouver wins this, we're done for. It'll be 3-1 for the Canucks. I think we're done. Sebastian Aho wins it. I think we're done. I think we're done. The Canucks have a 3-1 series lead. We lost in the conference final last year to the Blues. And we now have a 3-1 deficit to overcome in the second round against Vancouver. FYI. Dude, I have had 7 people be like, it's pronounced this way. That's why I call them omelet as a joke. Because I literally, that is about the 7th pronunciation of Ouellette, Ouellette, fucking Houlette, fucking Haku Makente, or whatever the fuck The Rock said in The Scorpion King, that I've heard for pronunciation. That's why we just call him Omelette, and it's fine. Or I'll call him Roulette Table. Good old Roulette over here. Not doing enough, clearly. Because we are one game away from our dynasty officially being over. Which, again, the point of this was to turn around and rebuild Edmonton. We have indeed, as the stream title said, we have indeed, and thanks for Circuit Chip for this, there has indeed been an oil change. However, it might be time to change the oil again. Granted, it's not as bad. Like, we didn't just have to change the oil. We had to rebuild the whole fucking car. Thanks a lot, Peter. If we step away here and say, okay, a new GM takes over as the dynasty ends, he'll have to change the oil. That's easy enough. Now you get rid of Besser, a couple of other guys, you're good to go. That said, I hope we're not done yet. It's game 5. Win or the dynasty is officially over. First period. Whoo, boy. Second period. It is over. The dynasty is officially over, guys. Didn't matter who the goaltender was. The dynasty is officially over. The dynasty's over. Three cups in a row. But we fall short in the playoffs and back-to-back seasons. Despite winning 60 games, Walstead wouldn't have lost. I disagree because he lost last year. But I get the meme. Oh, boy. It's not that hard to know where we fell short, I'd say. I mean, you can't end up with Capper's off on the fourth line. Andrews didn't put up a single point. And when perhaps the face of the series, Andrew Andrews, doesn't put up a point in 9 games, that's not a good sign. That's not a good sign. So, the dynasty is over. The dynasty is over. Time to blow it up and trade every player for picks. I think I am going to go through this offseason just to see how fun it's going to be to kind of have this team take a step back. maybe trade Demko again back to San Jose. I'm intrigued to see who ends up winning the cup. But we do fall short. Sinski never tweeted me, by the way. He doesn't want to jinx it like I did, I'm sure. He never tweeted me back. I'm very upset. But see, he learned his lesson. He learned his lesson. Vancouver ended up winning the whole damn thing. Wow. We had a better roster than them, too, by far. Vancouver wins the whole damn thing, sweeping Philadelphia in the final. Beating Vegas in 7 on the way there. So again, last year it was Florida. This year it was Vancouver. After we had won 3 straight cups. 'Tis a damn shame. We've won 4 out of the last 5 President's Trophies. McDavid won the Art Ross this year, and the Hart. Jones won the Norris. Lady Bing went to Kaprizov. Calder went to fucking Pierre John Michael Lafitte. Conn Smythe to DiPietro. Vezina to DiPietro. Not surprising. Jennings to DiPietro. Dumba. Ambul won the Selkie. McDavid to 10 Lindsay. The Rocket Richard went to Dorofeev. Oh, man. Well, at the very least, the whole idea of stacking this team to a ridiculous extent, it worked out. You know what the problem is? We lost Leon Draisaitl. And I think that's being overlooked in a part of our team's downward spiral, also known as losing in the 3rd round and the 2nd round. Fucking, we got rid of Draisaitl. And I think that was a massive problem. Granted, he and his $13 million might not have been worth it, but still. Carey Price, 454 wins. What a monster. Defensively, not a bad career at all for John Carlson. Or Torrey Krug, for that matter. And then forward-wise, of course, Patrick Kane. Duchesne and Couture both broke 900. Eberle retires. Klefbom was the lucky charm. Between Klefbom, between Draisaitl, I think you're right. We started getting away from more of the players and going over the top ridiculous. And, you know, I mean, I'm not going to say it didn't work out, because over the top ridiculous was a part of us winning those 3 cups. But eventually the luck ran out. Going the Chicago route of reuniting Demko with his old teammates didn't quite work. And I guess the question is, I'm sure they don't want to trade Walstead back. Even with Walstead, though. I'm tempted to trade back for him, to be honest. But I'm not sure what I'd want to do. Run with Tomek as the starter until Janssen or Bartley were ready. But I don't really think it would matter what goalie we had, to be honest. But I'd probably, you know, I think I will. Walstead, baby, come back. Will that go through straight up? I'm willing to trade away picks, don't worry. I'm going to handle this offseason as if I was still, you know, continuing. Because I don't know, I might. I'm not ready to say goodbye. I'm not. And I'd give up Muir to get Walstead back, because he's not going to develop. That way San Jose would at least have a project goalie out, you know, outside of Demko. I don't know if I'm ready to say goodbye. I'm disappointed that we lost again. I could have gotten a little bit more back than that. Then that second round pick, I could tell by your reaction you weren't done. I'm just disappointed that we lost again. But I brought back Wallstead. I mean, I gave up Muir and could have gotten like an extra first or another second back, but let's be honest, it's not a big deal. He was never going to develop anyway. So we bring back Wallstead after half a season, less than that. I thought Demko was going to be the solution. He wasn't. The problem is, I think I'm ready to break this defense apart. I think I'm ready to move on from the majority of this defense. Jones and Werenski both really let me down in the playoffs. Dominant regular season guys, but Werenski's been pretty damn good too, but I think that's one of the things I'm going to look to do is move on from that defense. Chicago, has the number one pick been made? It hasn't. Do they want to trade said pick? They don't, but however, yeah, I know, I literally told you, Dig, that I forgot that I didn't censor the Mafia episode, so it is what it is. It's a part of the game. They can't censor me for a part of the game. They can't censor me for not censoring a part of the game. Blame 2K check. So, Chicago, how would you like Jones and Werenski? And I have about 30 seconds to try and pull this trade off. Let's see what I can do. Because I think I'm good to get rid of him. If I can get this trade to go through first and foremost. Ah, bitch, I ran out of time. Ended up taking Manderville anyway. Detroit. Oh, wow, they actually want to trade that. Do you have anybody else that's interesting? Genther, Larkin, Chalosky, Cole Perfetti. All right, Detroit. Let's make a deal here, shall we? Like I said, I think I'm ready to move on from Jones and Werenski. Jones is going to start declining soon, and Werenski disappointed me a little bit. They have no cap space to pull this off. So this could be rough. But I think we need to move on to a younger defense. Let's see. Regula and Jared Spurgeon. Yeah, you'd be over the cap. Shit. Do you have anybody on an expiring deal? The problem is you can't get good prospects if the teams don't want to trade them. So, hey, I could take that Victor Hedman deal. And we'd still be about $2 million short. So that's rough. Montour's contract. Screw that. What about Spurgeon? Spurgeon enough? Detroit would still be over. Are you serious? What's even happening? Let's try to get this deal done. In the end, it might only be trading one of them. I'm not sure. Because I wouldn't be able to get enough back draft pick-wise to make it worth it. What if I also take Joe Valeno? This is probably just going to be a one-person trade. I think I'll look to give up Werenski to make this happen. I might have to give up both, to be honest, but like I said, I'm not going to be able to get as much back draft pick-wise as I'd want. Let's see if there's anything else. Get all the defense. We had all the defense. It didn't work out. I want DiPietro in goal. That's not happening. That is not happening. You want Brady Shea too, but the value might push it over? Maybe not. In fairness, I can drop those. I do have to add somebody back to this. And I don't know who the hell it's going to be. I guess it would be... Yeah, it could still be Spurgeon, that's fine. And let's see what else we can do here, Detroit. Because again, you don't have anybody that's going to be cheap enough to pick up. So, when in doubt, and when getting rid of the part of your core, you aim to get as many picks as possible. That's the way to do it. Value's too far off. Oh, is it? Oh, is it, I say. How about now? Is the value too far off now? Really? I thought that would have gone through. That's okay. How about an extra third? Wow. You are playing hardball with picks you want to get rid of. The Zach, like, I know that's a second overall pick and it has quite a bit of value, but I'm honestly very surprised that's not going through. Just a bit low. Still? Huh. I don't have any picks this year to get rid of anyway, so... how would you like my fifth and sixth next year? How about that? Are you... How is that not sweetening it just a touch? Fine, take the third from Dallas. Just give me the damn thing. Oh, yeah, we're gonna sign our free agents. Fuck you. I hate that. Why would you not mention that right out of the fucking gates? It's gonna be impossible for me to trade these guys. Isn't it? It's gonna be impossible. Because I'm gonna keep getting hit with that. Nashville? Nashville doesn't want to trade theirs. Okay, well. I don't know how the hell we're even going to blow this team up. There's one defenseman in the top five who I'd like to get. Does Arizona want to trade their pick, or am I going to have to overpay Nashville? Fuck. I guess I have my answer. I don't really want to send these guys to Western Conference teams either. So, Pittsburgh, hopefully the defenseman that I want is Joe Thornton gets the hat trick. Fucking kill me. Hey, the defenseman I wanted fell to Pittsburgh. Cool. Why are we blowing this team up? Because it's time. Because it's time. Oh, God. At least I think it's the hat trick for Joe, unless his goal was the one that was called back, but I don't believe it was. No, it's the hat trick. Okay, cool. So, this team failed us in the playoffs again. Including Jones and Werenski, both of whom I'm very disappointed in at this point. It's time to move on. It's time to move on. Alright, the problem is here, Pittsburgh is going to be very difficult to make deals with. Yeah, they're going to be very difficult to make moves with. Ah, Bruins playing way too flat. Well, you know, it doesn't help when they've played so many games in the past few days, you know? That doesn't help. But, yeah, kind of sucks that they're... I mean, this loss will be blamed on Tuca for the amount of goals given up. You know that for sure. I don't know if I'm going to be able to blow this team up. That's the problem. I think I'm kind of stuck with some members. There's a lot of moves I want to make, and I kind of have to make them. For the sake of cap space, I still really want to move on from Jones. I don't know how I'm going to pull this off. Guess I'm going to look at all the Eastern Conference teams and see who can work out a deal. But I'm guessing for the most part, it's going to be very difficult to do. Let's see. So like Boston, for example. Do you have anybody cheap that I could take? Like a Gallagher, that's perfect. Seth, it's time for you to go. It is. Unfortunately, it's going to have to be for like draft picks only, which really sucks. But we might be able to make this work. What do you say, Boston? 4 first round picks for getting old Seth Jones? Yeah, I'll take that. Seth Jones to Boston, which has become somewhat of a preferred dumping ground. Zach Werenski, you disappointed me more than Seth Jones did, so you can also leave. And we'll try to send you to Buffalo. Let's just stack the Atlantic Division. Why not? Although... Buffalo. How would you like to revisit a potential trade that we talked about a while ago? How would you like to revisit a certain very dumb trade idea? How would you like to revisit this idea? The good news is, I'll even send you Lundqvist, who I'll lose for nothing. I'll even send you Bradyshky. So, how close are we right now? They would take it with the exception of the salary cap retention. I haven't been getting notified of you going live. Yeah, Twitch sucks for that reason. So I highly recommend you following me on Twitter and joining the Discord as well. Because otherwise, you're just rolling the dice as to whether or not Twitch is going to tell you. And it's pretty dumb, but it is what it is. Is there anybody else? As if this team isn't stacked enough. And we have to trade so many forwards away, too. Gonna have to go draft pick-wise here, which is fine. We have plenty. How about that nice shiny Dallas second? I'm gonna say you're gonna take this because I want him on half salary. I want him on half salary for the next year. There you go. I'll take that. Didn't even have to give up too much to get him. So, Rasmus Dahlin, welcome. Welcome to Edmonton. Even though I'm kind of thinking we're taking a little bit of a step back this year, although once we acquire you, maybe we're not. I don't have the plan for this team at this point. It's just, what stupid trade could I do? See, the problem with this, like right now, right? Like, we have Makar and Dahlin on nothing. It's hilarious. It is hilarious. And then the problem here, like, if we were to continue, right, is that forward-wise, heads would have to roll, right? There's just too much talent here. There's just way too much talent here. Like, Besser would have to go for sure. Kaprizov would finally probably go as well with his lack of production in the playoffs. So I think I'm intrigued to know what this team would look like at the very least if I were to continue. And I still might. But Dahlin Makar is at least interesting because of how cheap Kale Makar is right now. Because we got him on half salary. He had 45 points this year. 7 points in 9 games in the playoffs. Potato, you're getting bopped. You know why. You're getting bopped. Oh boy. Do we still have double A? We do, but he underperformed tremendously in the playoffs. Oh, A. Sander, 13. Thank you for the follow. What's going on? I want to see how many good players we can get with those. I mean, a lot. The problem is, though, it's almost not worth it. It's almost not worth it to trade for players that teams don't want to, you know, give up. I mean, with Dahlin, it was, you know, a rare exception. But, so Lundqvist isn't going to be tradable. I might just let him go. And then we'd have Okposo, Sanlak, and Voros, which I'm not against maybe having them be the defense this year. It depends. But forward-wise, yeah, heads have to roll. And Besser and Kaprizov are the first two to go. Because, I mean, Besser's been getting it done in the play. It's weird. Kaprizov is a great regular season performer. Sucks in the playoffs. Besser is the inverse. Or at least he was this past year. It's, I don't know. It's really weird. Brock, how would you like to go to Carolina? How would you like to go to Carolina? Oh, something like Capocacco. I might just go draft picks again, though. I might. Even then, value-wise, it's going to be kind of rough. So, how about 5 first-round picks for Brock Besser? Thank you very much, Carolina. Probably could have gotten a little bit more for him, even. But Brock Besser joins that lovely bunch of jerks for 5 first-round draft picks. That'll probably be worth it for us in the future. And next up is Kaprizov. He has to go, too. He has to go, too. Unfortunately, it brings a tear to the eye. It really does. Or just something's in my eye and it's bugging me. I'm not sure which. Detroit. I tried making a deal with you earlier, but you were the whole, oh, my value, my re-signings. New Jersey, it's going to be a bit too much. Is there an Eastern team? Pittsburgh. I already made a deal with Pittsburgh, didn't I? For a bunch of firsts. Well, Pittsburgh, let's see if you want to work out a deal for a Kirill Kaprizov. That's not surprising. What if I take out a first? It's a good salary, though, for 2.5. I don't even know who you're referring to. If you're talking Kaprizov, sure, but he keeps underperforming in the playoffs, so if we were to keep him, he would be gone. Very, very gone. Let's see. What about just four firsts? No. It's all right. We will slowly, slowly whittle away at this value. And we'll work out a deal. It'll be worth it to us just to get rid of him and get something for him. It's on a scheduled night. This and probably finishing up Mafia 2 tonight. It's what it's looking like. Yeah, Pittsburgh not wanting to trade picks is a little bit rough. God, 257 left in that Bruins game, huh? Alright, Eastern Conference team that wants him. Columbus. I need a player with an expiring deal who's not worth all that much. Can you provide that? Not really is the correct answer. Mark Jankowski. Not gonna work. Columbus. Detroit was being dumb. New Jersey. Hey, Kyle Palmieri. I take that deal. You give me back a bunch of draft picks. And we see what everything's looking like. Right. Four first round picks for Kaprizov? Sweeten it just a touch. I can do that. How many first round picks do we have this year? 2, 3, 4, 5. Only 5, huh? How would you like that Dallas third? Kaprizov in a third for essentially 4 first round picks. Thank you very much, New Jersey. Thank you very much. What else do we have? Because this team, again, it's still going to be looking ridiculous no matter how we set it up. Technically, though, we have 4 first-line players, right? And technically, the top line could be Andrews, Hart, and Omelet, but I'm a little bit worried about Andrews. And that's why. He was a playoff hero, and then he very much wasn't. Problem is, too, some of these big-name guys, their contracts are up. Now, we have cap space because of who I've traded. But still, it's about to get very expensive. Yeah, it's pretty ridiculous. I mean, we've had so many first-round picks over the years, too. Let's see, so player role-wise. Problem is, even being like, I want to play these guys within their roles. They're going to get better. At least I would expect. Boston ties it! I didn't even see who the hell that was. It was Wagner. Beautiful. Well, I said 5-4 in a shootout. It might end up being 6-5. So, that works. Whew. Why is Andrews playing in the KHL? He sounds so American. He's not. He's... What? Don't you be reviewing this. Don't you be reviewing shit. You're not allowed. That might have been high. That might have been played with a high stick. That might have been played. I think you should allow it, though. Just gonna say. Just my 2 cents. Screw the rules. Since when do referees care about the rules, okay? Since when do referees in the NHL care about the rules? Good goal. High stick? That's debatable. Good goal. Don't you be selective with when you care about the rules, alright? Don't you be selective. Since when do you care? That's a good goal. That is clearly a good goal. Come on now. As if NHL referees know what a good goal looks like nowadays, right? Come on. That's a good goal. Good goal. Clearly. We have $19 million in cap space, right? God, we have so many big contracts coming up, too. Oh boy. This is rough. Because we could end up with a lot of RFAs. The funny thing is, the offense is still pretty well stacked without Besser and Kaprizov. Quit your bitching, Peter, and just throw the challenge flag. Or don't. Please tell me they're counting that goal. Drop the puck and count the goal! Please! Quit bitching about it, Peter. Quit bitching. Good goal. Nobody cares about the rules anymore. Come on. Drop the puck. Yeah, it counts. Fuck the rules. Tie game. Yes. Yes. God, the NHL is such a shit show. I love it. That outright, that was such a high stick. Like here's the crossbar. Fucking playing it way the fuck up here. It's beautiful. Yes. Oh, it's beautiful. What a shit show. God bless the NHL. Yes. Anyway. Oh, God. I don't know what the hell I'd even do with this team. The funny thing is, we're still set up to be stacked, but still. Visions, yeah, you picked a good time. I'm just trying to think of what to do with this team. Because here's the thing, right? And why I was thinking, okay, last season is because I knew we were going to be in cap hell. And we are, right? Because of these contracts coming up, it's a very bad situation to be in. I knew Besser, Kaprizov would be going. I had a feeling I was going to rework the defense anyway. So, it's not all that surprising. It's just how much would I want to change things up with these forwards? Like, do I trade anybody here? Or do I let certain people go? You know? That's the only question. That is the only question. But then again, we have like guys like Gallagher and Lundqvist, Palmieri that I'm going to be letting go of. I think I might be okay to reset this roster the way I want to. And if anything, I kind of view it as a challenge to see what this roster is going to look like. We only have 6 picks in this draft. They're all first rounders. I think we're good to move on, actually. We pick next. Is there anybody on the board that I actually want, or am I just going to end up trading for next year's picks? Let's find out. Medium 4, medium 6. Decent ratings on Nekar. Not quite Tatar, but still, Nekar. Still so worried about this Bruins game. 5 seconds away from a point. Clear it, Kevin. Thank you. Going to overtime. I called extra time between San Jose and Boston, even though Boston had a 3-0 lead when I typed it. So, I called it. Actually, it might have been 3-1 at that point, but still. Oh, God. Hold on, I gotta respond. Here, hold on. Here, let's live respond to somebody on Twitter, right? So here's what I said in relation to Saad's complaint about people not saying Patrick Kane isn't the greatest American. He is. This guy's response is antics are not irrelevant. My argument is that in the sports world, you can be as big of a piece of shit as you want. People will often forget about it and let it slide if you're that great. So that's my response to that. Is it irrelevant that Kane has had some off-ice antics? No, but in the topic of conversation of is he great? Yeah, it is. Yeah, it is. There's a lot of scumbags that people still praise to this fucking day because they were good at sports ball or sports puck. So, yeah. Or, you know, how about Mike Tyson? You know, one of the best fucking boxers ever. Muhammad Ali might have been just a tad bit racist himself. This, you know, there's some people who, perhaps rightfully so, don't view Muhammad Ali as having been a great person at certain points in his life. He's still the best fucking boxer of all time. So, I've always hated that argument. Anyway. God, I don't know about these medium potentials. Gordon Tanaka. Oh, boy. Wow, there's actually not that many medium elites here, huh? Do I want the medium 9s or the medium 4s? Hunter Harding, huh? There's a low elite. Stefan Stahlberg. Do I want to trade out of the first round for high value? Or do I just take those half-decent players for the hell of it? That's the honest question. Because I'm going to be very tied up in watching this overtime. And I'm kind of worried about it. I think I'm going to only go for value. Which means... we are going to take this time out and probably trade these picks. Which, you know, is the best way to go. Like I said, I'm kind of playing it in the way I would in case Michael Jordan would gamble thousands of dollars. Well, I mean, there's the difference, though, between gambling and a lot of the other accusations, you know? There's a difference between gambling and someone being like, ah, Mike Tyson went to prison for rape. There's a bit of a difference there. You know, the fans are still booing. Good, they should. In all likelihood, San Jose should win this game, but I hope they lose. You know? Oh, boy. Let's see. Wow. Okay, low elites. Jesus. Come on, Boston. Win this game a ref puck. Bobby Hull. No one really expanded upon the Bobby Hull accusations. It was just kind of that one story, and then there was never really a follow-up. Oh, Tuca. I think he missed, though. Like I said, though, Patrick Kane and the whole rape accusations and everything. That's the problem, though. If you're a great sports athlete, nobody gives a shit. I mean, people give a shit, but if you think, like, oh, Patrick Kane's not going to be in the Hall of Fame, I got some bad news for you, you know? He's going to be. Michael Vick, that's all. Exactly. Exactly. I mean, a lot of people are like, oh, it wasn't humans, it was dogs. It's not that bad. Which is like, holy fuck, you're a psychopath. But the Ray Lewis thing, too, of course, is more accusation as opposed to anything confirmed. Dead set confirmed, at least. So, you know, people won't use that one as an excuse, but oh, God. It's like, oh, Craig McTavish. He killed somebody in a DUI. Does he still work in an NHL front office to this day? Yeah. If you're good at what you do or you're a good athlete, people tend to forgive and forget. That's just how it is. So, like I said, to that, my response to that of like, oh, Patrick Kane and his accusations, that's not irrelevant. It's like, it is, though, in terms of how people are going to view him. Like, regardless, people are going to view Patrick Kane as the best American hockey player of all time. If he isn't already there, he will be by the end of the, you know, by the end of the discussion. So, I don't know. For anybody to be like, oh, it's not a relevance. Slava Voynov is relegated to life. Yeah, well, Dominator, here's the thing, though. Slava Voynov gets paid millions of dollars in Russia and won Olympic gold a year ago. What a punishment. He's a great hockey player, so, yeah. Here's money, go win Olympic gold. You can't possibly view it as, oh, well, no, this is going to, like, you know, Patrick Kane, like, again, the argument for me was, you know, his off-ice antics are irrelevant in terms of the topic of conversation, you know, being, is he the best American hockey player of all time? He is. He is. Like, his off-ice antics, the accusations and everything, whatever the fuck happened, it's like, it's just going to be looked past. It already is. You know, look at the Ronaldo thing. I mean, again, no one's, you know, there hasn't been any confirmation, but Cristiano Ronaldo do something he probably shouldn't have done? From the looks of it, probably. Is he going to get away with it? Sure. Fuck, Ronaldo just had to pay how much in back taxes? He's not spending a day in jail. No fucking way. He's too good at what he does. Fucking, you look at Jose Mourinho. What are we talking about? Okay, so the topic of discussion, Knucklehead, turned into this, right? Saad put up this post, this tweet, about people being clueless that Patrick Kane's not the greatest American of all time. I had my response, which, you know, the main arguments against Kane not being the best American hockey, I think I said North American, the argument of Kane not being the greatest American hockey player of all time, people who use his off-ice, you know, accusations against him, which I said, and this topic of discussion is irrelevant. And it is. Because people don't care. If you're good enough at a sport, people will forget and forgive. Forgive and forget. They won't give a fuck. Whether it's, you know, fucking rape. Mike Tyson, still considered one of the best of all time. If you look at Cristiano Ronaldo and fuck everything that's gone on with soccer players, you know, trying to dodge taxes overseas. Who gives a fuck? You're not going to serve a day in prison. You're too good at kicking a ball. I also mentioned, you know, if you compare like Kane to Madonna, people would be like, well, Madonna played at a more defensive time and Madonna didn't have as good of a team. But, you know, this was this dude's response. You know, being good at a sport never excuses you from being a terrible person. In reality, you know, in a perfect world, sure, it doesn't. In reality, it does. Patrick Kane's going to be a Hall of Famer. Shitty, horrible people who have done horrible things are still praised to this day. And they will be. That's the way it works. If you're good enough at something, people don't give a fuck. That's how it works, man. That's how it works. Oh, God. How many people did I even pin to potentially draft? That's the real question. O.J. Simpson. That's the thing. A lot of people be like, yeah, O.J. Simpson murdered her, right? And what was it, Rod Goldman? He totally did it, but God, what a football player. You know? Not just athletes, any businessmen. True. True. Or Lance Armstrong, can't deny he was the best Oh, Lance Armstrong, great cyclist. Probably one of the best ever, without even cheating. Also did a lot of good for charity. So people are like, okay. Yeah, he cheated, but look at all the good that he did. So nobody gives a fuck. Or you'll always see, like, ah, everyone else is cheating anyways, so who gives a fuck? He was the best of the cheaters. You know? But I'm not even talking, like, you know, performance-enhancing stuff. I'm talking legitimate laws broken or harming other people. You know, people will still be praised. Knucklehead, yeah, I mean, Benoit's a good comparison. I mean, even I, to this day, you know, it's like the topic of conversation with Benoit is often, well, number one, you'll have the topic of conversation be whether or not you believe he was in his right mind or not. And then from there, it always goes to, such a shame, though, because holy fuck, is he one of the best ever. As far as what he did, right? That's always a part of the conversation. I'm guilty of that, too. It's like, you know, it's just, it is what it is. Barry Bonds cheated, should be in the Hall of Fame. Bruins win! 6-5! Yes! See? Don't say cheaters don't prosper. The Bruins tie it with a high stick and win the game. Don't tell me cheaters never prosper. San Jose got jobbed. San Jose just got jobbed. Whew. Aaron Hernandez isn't the same level. People admit that Aaron Hernandez was a good football player, but he's not like one of the best of all time. You know, people will, you know, again, it's not like, oh, hey, this guy did something, you know, shitty. The topic of conversation is whether or not, you know, for example, is Patrick Kane still going to be a Hall of Famer despite, you know, the fucking rape accusations? Yeah, he is. Is he the best American hockey player of all time? He is. I'm sorry, like, the accusations there, you know, that's not going to take away from him eventually being a Hall of Famer. It's just not. Flo, what's going on, buddy? A little bit of ranting and raving. So, I don't know. Like I said, that's my only response to, like, oh, Patrick Kane's off-ice antics aren't irrelevant. They're, you know, to the topic of conversation being him, you know, him being the best American hockey player of all time. They are irrelevant because nobody's, I'm sorry, like, Patrick Kane's not going to miss out on eventually making it to the Hockey Hall of Fame in 10 to 15 years because of those accusations. People are still going to vote him in. Ben Roethlisberger still gets into the conversation of top 10 quarterback. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, athletes. Let's see. Greatest athletes. Oh, God. I don't know. How would I type this in? I don't know. It's just, I don't know, man. There's a lot, right? OJ is probably the biggest one, though. OJ is probably the biggest. I mean, OJ or Mike Tyson might be the greatest example, right? Especially with the fact that, what, Tyson served 3 years in jail? I mean, fuck. And then Tyson's revenge is eventually getting a show on TV with his fucking pigeons. You know? So, I don't know. Anyway, am I going to have to call another timeout here? Probably. Probably. Alright, one more time out. This is the longest amount of time in between me actually making a pick. You know, Tyson's more popular now than he's ever been. Pretty much. Pretty much. Like I said, you guys are, like, some of you in chat are mentioning stuff that's kind of irrelevant, though. Like the last comment about, oh, these people did cocaine when they played. I mean, come on. There's a little bit of a different level between going to prison for rape and that. So, we're talking different levels here, guys. We're talking different levels. Keep that in mind. There's a different level, too, between cheating like a Lance Armstrong and like what Mike Tyson did, yet he's still praised, you know? So, like I said, as far as Patrick Kane and the rape accusations, you know, is that going to be in the conversation? Sure, but at the end of the day, he's still already the best American player of all time and will be remembered as such until somebody passes him, you know? That said, how did that end? Wasn't it not that, I was gonna say, because there was something about the girl's mother who, you know, like, orchestrated, I don't know, the whole Patrick Kane thing was weird. Anyway, it's fine. Heatley and his drunken speeding that killed Dan Snyder. Yeah, that's another decent example. Like I said, there's a couple of examples of, DUI-related deaths, and the player involved comes back and is like, hey, how you doing? I'm still in the league. So, you know. It is what it is. Dark conversation. They got into, but as I said, so yeah, I can just quietly type my response or just say, yeah, fuck it, let's discuss. You know, I'm actually gonna make these picks here. Vaclav Nekar, welcome. 72, not bad. When's our next pick? If anybody else that was still interested is on the board. Not on the cover though, Joe Sakic on 04. He was on the cover, let's be honest. The Joe Sakic cover is very hard to get a hold of, I've discovered. Like, very hard. Very hard to get a hold of. Because I looked when I bought my copy of 04. It's like the Sackett covers, like, was only available on, like, PC. It's kind of weird. Alright. Let's see. I need to trade down. Actually, do I have another pick before 26? I do. I can trade down my next two picks to next year. You could probably make an all-criminal team for most of the sport. Yeah, you could. You legitimately could. Greg Hardy. Greg Hardy's a really good example, actually. Now, again, the topic of discussion will then shift to, well, second chances, and that is what it is. But, you know, Greg Hardy, that's a pretty good example. It's like, ah, yeah, well, you beat the shit out of your girlfriend slash wife, whatever one it was. Welcome to the UFC. People don't care. If you are a good enough athlete, any bullshit you pulled harming other people, people will look the other way. That was the point. Maybe I shouldn't have used the word irrelevant, but, you know. It will be irrelevant. So, I don't know. Like I said, to that topic of, you know, Scott Hall killed a man. That's a different situation, though. But, I don't know. What have you done for me lately, sports world? Yeah, pretty much. Pretty much. Oh boy, I don't know what team I'm going to be able to trade these picks to. I'd prefer not to trade it to a Western team. Washington, please have this work out. Please have this work out. Rey Mysterio killed a guy. That was an accidental death, though. I say that as a fan of Pero Aguayo Jr. That was just a fucking horrible accident. As opposed to, you know, say a Jimmy Snuka situation. So, when you outright be like, oh, Rey Mysterio killed somebody, it was an accident in the ring. It's not like you fucking shot somebody, you know? So, there's, again, different levels to a lot of what you guys are bringing up in chat compared to what I'm kind of mentioning, right? So, just to make that point clear. What do you say, Washington? Yeah, I figured you'd take that trade. That's fine. I gotta be honest, though. I know he did, but I know it's an accident, but he still did. To me, there's a difference. I mean, when you say someone killed someone, that frames it as murder as opposed to an accident. You know. And to me, there's a difference, too, between like, oh, well, yeah, well, not really. I mean, again, there's a difference here, Hulk, right? Between when you say Rey Mysterio killed someone, there's a difference between, like, killed someone associates that more with murder as opposed to accident, you know? And there's probably even more of a difference between accident and, I mean, I don't even know if you want to, you know, label fucking, like, the Mysterio case as an accidental homicide, because even that makes it seem like Rey did something negligent that led to it, which isn't the case. Ah, big game, what's going on, man? We're having a very random discussion, but that's kind of what happens here. Aiden! Aiden with the 8 months, saving me from myself in this very weird conversation. What's going on, man? Appreciate that solid 8 month. It's kind of crazy to me how many people, you know, like 8 month, 18 month. It's still weird to me. When is our next pick worth making here? As this whole, what would this team look like if we continue deal has been completely derailed. Completely derailed. Let's see, we had the 44th. Alright, so we gotta get down into like the 40s and the 50s. So 32. Alright, let's trade to right about here with Montreal and Calgary. See what's up. Isn't that what manslaughter is? An accident when the when murder's supposed to plan? I don't know, though. Yeah, I mean, Void, if you're, like I said, I don't know, that might technically be the correct term. But to say that Rey Mysterio was involved in, like no. No, it doesn't. Mysterio was involved in the manslaughter with Paro. No. This is not online franchise. There is no online franchise in NHL. Or GM Connected, as it was called, when it was involved. Anyway, we should totally change the topic of discussion. It's gotten weird. It's gotten weird, but I do stand by my original point of when people discuss Patrick Kane. Then, you know, the topic of conversation when it's, oh, is he the greatest American of all time? You're gonna have some people say no because of the rape accusations, but let's be honest, at the end of the day, he's gonna be a Hockey Hall of Famer and he's gonna be on top of a lot of the best of all time lists over guys like Mike Modano and whoever the hell else. That was the point. Are the Islanders for real? At this point, yeah. At this point, yeah. I don't like doubting people after what Vegas did last year. D-Mart, thank you for the follow, man. Appreciate it. Very much appreciated. Oh, boy. I will respond to that guy on Twitter later, because I don't feel like typing it now. Oh, boy. Oof, wow, I moved up at the exact proper time. Taglia, welcome aboard. Didn't even need to do anything illegal, just cast your shadow on like Tiger Woods, you went from the best call. I mean, adultery's kinda shitty. You know? I'm gonna say that, gotta believe. Adultery's kinda shitty. Just a little bit. So, while not illegal, adultery is a good enough reason for, you know, society to cast a shitty shadow on you. That said, again, there is the whole, how long does one have to suffer being under that shadow before it's like, okay, you kind of move on, let that person live their life. And that's certainly a, you know, a whole nother debate. But, oh boy. All right, I want to trade down, get that one of the half decent player, and see what we're dealing with heading into next season. I do have a fifth round pick in this year's draft, but still, we're gonna move on. Try to trade for picks next year with LA. That probably won't go through. Yeah. How about I get rid of that? How about just a second next year? Damn. I'll take a third round pick next year. Let's do it. Don't even know if we'll end up getting to that draft. We'll find out, won't we? There we go. Thank you, LA. I gotta turn off my TV now. The Bruins absolutely stole a point away from San Jose. Oh boy, I what are the odds Leafs fans right now are claiming there has to be at least one Leafs fan claiming conspiracy that the league wants the Bruins to have home ice against the Leafs in the first round, which is why that Wagner goal counted. If I go to our hockey right now, I guarantee there's a Leafs fan who's claimed that. I'm not saying like Leafs fans think this. I'm thinking that has to be an idea that one person had. I don't know why that just came to mind, but I guarantee somebody thinks the Bruins getting that extra point, there's a conspiracy against the Leafs. I'm sorry if that's a very out of nowhere opinion, but tell me I'm wrong. Tell me I'm wrong. Oh, Lapista. Wow, Lapista is better than I would have thought. All right, this draft is over with. It's because the Leafs don't want the Habs in the playoffs? Oh, that's a good one, too. That's a good one, too. I honestly never even thought of that. I don't know. For some reason, my mind just very randomly went to like, okay, what's like the dumbest... What's the dumbest thing that could come out of the Bruins stealing a point there because the NHL is stupid? I don't know. I feel like someone would have had that opinion. Right? I'm just saying. The post-match thread's a good read. I can only imagine. I'll be avoiding it like the fucking plague. I avoid Reddit post-game threads anyway, like the goddamn plague. So, alright. Let's see what we have here. So we have $41 million in cap space to work with. Alright, like I said, I'm gonna build this team as if I was still going to keep everything together. I'm going to try to bring back Tomek. We have to sign Bartley to his ELC. Lagasse was signed for the year. So the goaltending situation still set with us bringing back Wallstedt. Defensively, I'm still going to let Lundqvist go. We're going to sign Okposo, who wants a little bit more than what I was hoping for, but that is okay. Let's go like 1 year, $3 million. He'll retain RFA status. The game had so many missed calls, blown calls, weird goals, weird bouncing pucks. Everything was just odd. The game was entertaining, fun to watch. But I had that kind of game instead of over-officiated, over-reviewed hockey game. Yeah! I don't know. I'd still prefer the league to get everything right, which is probably never going to happen. So, wishful thinking, right? But, I don't know. But, like, I'm not going to sit here, like, put it this way. The Sharks got jobbed. They did. I could not sit here and be like, if that happened to the Bruins, I wouldn't care. I'd be fucking furious if the Bruins, if the tying goal happened and then they lost in overtime, I'd be throwing shit across the room, just cursing the league. So, thoughts on the shot that crossed the line? I don't know if it did or not. I don't even know. It's fucking, who knows? But put it this way, I'm not going to say the Bruins deserve to win that game. They blew a 3-0 lead. So, that's the only thing that matters. The Bruins got a fucking lucky-ass point off of a hosed call. That all comes out in the... It all comes out in the wash is a very good way to look at it, though. It does. It does. So, or it is. That's a good way to look at it. Oh, we can drop those two who are trade tack-ons. It's like Fox needs a deal, Hart, Marlow, Frazee. A lot's going to have to change about this team, which is fine. We were prepared for it. Like I said, that's why I'm not against if we do step away from things with Edmonton here. Hopefully I can get this guy in the finish series. If we do step away, it was because more than likely, I mean, we were going to have to make these changes anyway, is the point. I've gone over that. You know how this works. So, only thing I wanted to check was whether or not there was a defenseman worth signing. Like, sure, is worth signing. Did he play in junior, though? He did not. So, Braxton, you'll be playing in the AHL this year. Remberg can stay. It's a bit too low. I'm not sure what I'm doing with Fox yet. Strong. I mean, he should be... Jesus, he killed the OHL. He should have as an overager, though. You'll be good enough to be in the AHL this year. Crazy, you're just not going to make it. And you're not even really going to have that much trade value. So we'll just ditch you. Canzanello. Good old Bear. I forgot all about Bear Canzanello. Great name. Great name. Bear Canzanello. Good stuff. Bataglia is a bit too low of an overall. And then center-wise, LaBarbera. WHL, so we will not be signing him. Actually signed Chris Wagner to a joke of a contract. Jake and Smallwood, our AHL captain. Signed him to a 3-year deal. He's going nowhere. Captain of Bakersfield. And Holmstrom's going to need a new deal too. So, with all those deals, we should be able to make this happen. We should be able to keep everything rather cohesive. Canzanello, Shirokov, Shore, Strong, Karpatsev, Bartley, Nekar, Smallwood, Tomek, Okpozo. Everyone signed. Good. Good. Oh, boy. Give me a second here. I want to stoke a Twitter war. I don't. I'm kidding. Can't type the word accusations, I've learned. One second. Let's see. There we go. That'll be fun. That'll be fun. All right. So, 37 mil to put this team together. It's not a bad place to be. Fox needs a deal. It's actually not as bad as I would have thought it would be. Let me open up ye olde calculator app on the PC. What are we dealing with? 3.8. I'll keep it at 4. Hopefully he signs that. Hopefully. Time is, wow, it's 1:18 in the morning. Jesus. Jimmy needs a deal. He wants the full 8. Not bad. Get that contract out of the way. Let's go to 6.5 is the lowest. Let's go 6.5. Marlowe needs a deal. Good chance he ends up getting traded, but still. Oh yeah, I'm gonna have all the money in the world to bring people back. Might have gone a little bit overboard getting rid of the likes of Werenski and Jones, but I felt like Jones might regress after the next season, and that Zach Werenski wasn't really worth keeping on his own. I might be wrong. And then center is Yashim. Also needs a deal. He's not looking to stay for that long, but that's okay. We'll drop that down to like 5.5. That might be a bit too low. 5.2 would be the 85%. And Holmstrom. Just let me save a little bit of money. We'll see if that works. Oh boy. I haven't heard from Sin yet either on Twitter. Fox rejected, Marlowe rejected. All right, cool. I haven't heard from Sin yet on Twitter, and I'm kind of concerned. You know what? Hold on. Let me see what's up here. Let me see what's up. Oh boy. There we go. That's a good tweet. That's a good tweet. That's a good tweet. Alright, wanted to go all expiring. So Fox and Marlowe, we have $26 million to spend. I honestly thought it was going to be worse. Did I drop Fox down to $4 million? I think I did. But I ended up having a lot more cap room than I thought. Maybe. Possibly. Like I said, I knew it was going to be... If we tried to keep everybody... It was going to be rough. Like, if we kept Jones, if we kept... Actually, yeah, if you think about that. If we kept Jones, if we kept Werenski, it would have at least been close. Right? It would have at least been close. I'm not entirely sure if it all would have fallen apart. I'm trying to think of who else we got rid of, though. Right? We got rid of Jones. We got rid of Werenski. We ended up bringing in Rasmus Dahlin. Huh. What else did we get rid of? I don't even remember. It's weird. It's weird. Pixin. Oh, cool. I can't see the trades from the draft, even though it happened 2 days ago. Thanks, EA. As opposed to FIFA, where you can see everything that's happened in a calendar year. I can't see what happened like 4 days ago. That's unfortunate. So, $19 million to spend in free agency. Which honestly actually isn't that bad, because again, I'd probably look to bring in some defensive help if we wanted to go overboard. Yeah, it could be okay. People are dying in the chat. Yeah, I know, but if someone was really dying in the chat, they wouldn't be taking the time to type. So, you know, why feed into the drama, right? Why feed into the drama? I forgot to renew my scouts. That's okay. That's okay. Free agents this year. Free agents this year. Svechnikov, Kotkaniemi, Jack Hughes. Good lord. Ralph Penner is a free agent. As is Morgan Riley, who has led the Canucks to a lot of success. Or at least one Stanley Cup. After finally getting past us. And goalie-wise, Nedeljkovic. Hatcher was the backup in Vancouver, wasn't he? I think he was. And Leonard still hasn't retired. Oh, boy. Oh, man. Alright. Let's see. We still have the champions tag, which isn't that surprising. Alright, you know what? The problem with this roster right now, right, is that we're not going to be able to make a decision until we see how players, you know, progress heading into the new season. So, boss man, what's up? Appreciate the follow, man. Welcome to whatever the hell this stream is. I don't have an answer for that, but welcome aboard. defensively, any good prospects? Nilsdorp, not really. So there is the option to go after Morgan Riley like we did for PK Subban. So there's that. What is going on in the chat? Fuck's sake. Stop it. All of you. Stop. You're gonna start getting slapped. I'm gonna shame you. Stop it. Anyway. Morgan, I won't give you a 7-year deal. But I will give you a 1-year deal in case you fall. Well, nah. I mean, I did just trade Jones and Werenski. So, you know. Signing Morgan Riley would be kind of against what I was looking to do. But it's very tough not to. It's very tough not to. I don't know. That would be the ultimate revenge on Vancouver, though, to sign Morgan Riley and then win with him. But, I mean, defensively, we do have Okposo, Sanlak, and Voros. I kind of want to see what they're going to look like. Because I could easily bring in another defenseman, because we're going to have to trade some forwards. We have to trade some forwards. So, I got to be honest. I think I'm just going to stay put with the roster as it is and then see how certain players develop. Just to see who I'd end up getting rid of. I mean, obviously, like, Hughes and Kotkaniemi, Svechnikov are there, too. It's ridiculous. Bringing back Ralph Penner would be hilarious. Because he has been quite good since I got rid of him. Those last two seasons. He has been very, very good. I don't know. But we have $19 million to spend. It's so tough not spending it. Riley's a 40-point guy. Werenski was technically better, although Riley might break out being a part of this team. Yeah, you know, fuck it. Morgan, how would you like a 1-year deal? There's no guarantees that you're gonna... It would be expensive. I'm not doing it. Forward-wise, though... Oh, Penner. How expensive is Penner going to be? Jesus, San Jose wants to keep him, too. Oh, God. I'm not even sure if all this matters. Let me look at the team really quickly. There's half the players I'm debating signing anyway I could trade for soon if I wanted to. 19.9 million in cap. I do kind of need to spend a little bit of money. But I mean, forward-wise, the core is still ridiculous. And again, I have to get rid of people. Because people aren't progressing the way they should be. They're being held back. Even though it's led to success. Over the last 2 years, not so much. Yeah, I do need to kind of spend to the cap. Alright, well, I don't really like signing people just to trade them. I mean, I totally do. But not all the time. Let's see. Let's see if we can spend a bit of money. Why not? Let's go for it. So, Morgan, you're not going to be given a 7-year deal at 33 years old. How about a nice shiny 2-year deal? I'll give you 8 mil. See if he accepts it. Hopefully, he will. And then from there, Penner is also going to get my other offer. Because he's a beast who should have been on this team the whole time. Even though that's drastically overpaying. Drastically. But he does like to score goals. The problem is we have way too many other people that are still that good. Fuck. I'm going to sim forward. This is a weird spot to be in. As we have somewhat retooled and freed up a decent amount of cap space. I want to see how these younger players are going to develop. Riley actually accepted, which I didn't think he would. But that does leave me the ability to sim forward here, get to the preseason, and be good to go. Right. Right. It does leave me the ability to sim forward, see how the forwards progress, and then figure it out from there. And then depending on how this team looks, we might do another season. We might not, even though the dynasty is totally over. You can't lose in 2 straight years and still call yourself a dynasty, can you? Probably. But still. Oh, man. I admittedly, I'm looking at some of the reaction on Twitter to the Bruins win. Joe Thornton gets a hat trick and the Bruins win it somehow. Go figure. Somehow. Also known as a high stick. Also known as a high stick. Oh boy. Peter DeBoer. It was above his shoulders. Did DeBoer already use a challenge? Or is it like NFL style? You're not allowed to challenge in the last 2 minutes? I'd never fucking notice. Blame yourself, Peter, even though it might not have been your fault. That's all I'm saying. Blame yourself, Mr. DeBoer. Oldest player to score a hat trick. Joe Thornton, 5th on that list. Damn. Is it sad that Joe Thornton turns 40 soon? You can't challenge in the last 2. Yeah, that's right. That is the rule, isn't it? I didn't remember if it was the last 2, the last 5, or what the hell it was. I'm surprised there wasn't a booth review, but I don't care. The Bruins were the beneficiaries, so it's fine. Can't challenge a high stick, but McAvoy's game winner, right? Is Thornton retiring this year? Probably not. I don't know when the hell he's going to retire. Like, between, like, him, guys like Luongo. They'll just Brady it and retire whenever the hell they want. All right, so our goaltending's set no matter what. Defensively, Dalian Makar, Riley already dropped 2 points, which I had a feeling was coming. Andrzejczyk, Okpozo, Sanlak, and Boros. Yeah, Riley's probably getting dealt soon. Not that I like signing people and immediately dealing them, but he's probably getting dealt. And then forward-wise, Jesus Christ. Yeah, we have to make a decision. This team, I'm not saying we'd have to fully optimize by player role, but it would help. Which means McDavid, Omelette, Hart, and Andrews. Andrews was super disappointing last year. I think Andrews would be on the way out. As crazy as that is. Now would either be the time to trade McDavid, Omelette, Hart, or Andrews. And it should probably be Andrews after his playoff disappointment. Again, no points in 9 games. Which is absolutely brutal. We need a franchise left wing. We have a franchise left wing. Hart, I mean, he's been playing on the second and third line, so those numbers aren't that bad. Same for Omelette. And what could be viewed as the sign of the end times, I don't know, man. Andrew Andrews or Connor McDavid, I think it's going to be one or the other. Doesn't matter that Asham has more value. He'd be a second liner. I gotta be honest, man. I think it would be Andrews, and I keep McDavid. Andrews, buddy, I think your time here is done, unfortunately. I'm gonna get in trouble. I'm gonna get in trouble for trading Morgan Riley this early, but let's be honest, I'm not gonna be GM of this team for that much longer anyway, so I'm not gonna have to deal with the consequences. But I do wonder if I have... if I have the top four of Dolly Makar, Andrew Chuckin, and let someone like Okpozo actually develop, how the defense would do this year. There's also the other issue of cap space-wise, I could immediately get in trouble. That is a very distinct possibility. There's also a guarantee, or not a guarantee, I'm going to be able to make a deal here. Preferably to an Eastern Conference team that has interest in them. Can't we just stick everyone in the minors and have a perfect season there? It'd actually be really funny to see if they would have a perfect season. I doubt they would, though. There's no way they'd win every game. I'm, like, so confident in that prediction that it's not even worth trying. Just knowing how this game works. Carolina. I'm not sure how interested you are in trying to make this happen. You also already don't have your first round picks because of a trade I made with you earlier, so never mind. Florida. I'd have to take back at least one person, and if I do, it kind of makes this deal not worth it. But, you know. Let's see. What if we were to take back Sarah Noel? Yeah, it would be three first-round picks for those two combined. Probably not worth it. So outside of Florida. Montreal. Is there a team where this is going to be like a perfect fit? And the answer is very much no. So it was Florida at 48. No, they were at 49 too. Montreal! It's worth trying so we can play the EA when they miss the playoffs, right? I mean, they wouldn't miss the playoffs. So if we sent down like all of our best players to the AHL, they're not going to miss the playoffs. Come on. Wouldn't matter how bad their goalie is or anything like that. They wouldn't miss the playoffs. Let's see. 29, 30, 31. And this isn't going to go through because they're going to need a player back, which is fine. McDavid still struggles to be a point of game in the AHL, right? That'd be the best way to do it. We'll take back Parsons here. It still probably isn't worth it to me, but damn it, I need to get rid of people, and there's really no other way to do it. Unless I trade them individually, which, to be honest, is probably for the best. Which means old Andrews here. I hate to do it, buddy, but... you gotta go. You've been jumped on the depth chart. So let's go with that beautiful 2031 as well. Four first round picks. Rejected. Not totally surprising. His trade bar isn't full. What about that beautiful second that you don't want to trade? Sweeten it just a touch so that beautiful second that you do want to trade will probably have that go through. Or not, because logic. Oh my god, the amount of picks we already have in the next few years. I'll trade just some nothing in return. Andrews is gone! A sign of the end times. Andrews is gone to Montreal. It is very disappointing. Can McDavid get to a point of game in the AHL? Insert emoji and thumbnail. That's actually a really good idea. That is actually a very, very good idea, Donna. Can he make, and if he doesn't make it with like just normal AHLers next to him? Oh God. Oh goodness. Okay. But you know what? We might do that. Like right now. Let me set up this roster. And then I think I'll make it a separate save file. I think that's a hell of an idea. The question is whether or not, you know, we'd want it to be like this McDavid or like the normal default McDavid. But the question is, like, would it be an AHLer? Or like, would it be like the all AHL team next to him? Or would I put him with like other superstars? Right? Now quickly here, I need to pay Jared Spurgeon a lot of money. Quickly. And we'll see how that goes. And right about there. Just so that I can get away with trading. Morgan Riley, probably. Because I think he's gone. Oh, sim to a regular season. Spurgeon, accept it immediately. Also. Nah, I'm not doing the Spurgeon meme. We've seen enough of that. Don Cherry's not a popular enough person anymore to ride that meme into the dirt. Anyway, let's see. So Morgan, I'm sorry, but you're out of here. I didn't forget the Spurgeon thing. I literally said I wasn't going to hit it. See, that's why you don't jump to conclusions. Because don't you look foolish. Florida, how would you like a nice shiny Morgan Riley? He would help your defense quite a bit from the looks of it. I'll take that dude you don't want. And you give me a nice shiny Morgan Riley. Or the inverse, I give you a nice shiny Morgan Riley. And I steal a ton of your draft picks. Sound good? Probably doesn't sound good enough. Sweeten it just a touch. I can do that. Oh, 2028, Jesus Christ. Well, that's interesting. Okay, how is a fifth and a seventh not a touch? Define a touch. Good Lord. It's a good thing EA doesn't write laws. Oh my God. Like, what's legally drunk? 0.02, 1.7, 1.7, you'd be dead, by the way, for anybody who doesn't get that reference. Hey, not legally drunk unless you're dead. Like, what? Oh, God. Alright, let's see. Forward-wise, does anybody else have to go? Probably. Alright, so I think that's our first line. Our second line, Marlowe's been a consistent performer there. I mean, Yashim and Vorobyev probably aren't going anywhere. Man, Fox is a one-trick pony and a half. Like, he has no shot. I think Reese Fox is going to be on the way out as well, which is insane. I think Fox is going to be on the outside looking in. Third line's good. Cardwell's going to start the year down in the AHL. So I need to bring in a couple of fourth liners if I'm not just going to, like, crazily stack the team this year. So I need to sign, like, 2 fourth-line talents just for the year. Any veteran we can get. Touch can be a second or a seventh, pretty much. You have a cunning plan to trade Fox. I see what you've done there, and I can't believe you've done this. So many different memes. All right, forwards. Forwards. Who wants to play in the NHL this year? Teply. The Teply. You know what? Let's do it. Michal Teply. How would you like to be an NHLer this year? Because for once, I'm not going to stack the roster, and we'll sign Kepin as well and see if that's enough. Hopefully it is. In the meantime, I'm going to go and trade Fox. And I want to see what this roster looks like with us being in quote-unquote retooling mode. Let's see. It's going to be Fox. You are on the way out. I don't know to where or for whom, although Washington looks like a safe bet. Washington looks like a safe bet. How would you like to trade me Luke Toporowski? And I'll take back a ton of draft picks. Let's see. Although a ton of draft picks might not be accurate. But damn it, we're going to try. What do you say, Washington? I mean, there's no way that goes through, obviously. I'll take out that one. I'll take out that one. Still rejected. Okay. I know that pick has a lot of value, right? So let me just double check this here, though. Come on, Washington. Damn it. I'm not going to be able to get that much back for him out of Washington, but they're projected to be terrible. So, you know, maybe. All right, Washington, it's not going to work out. This relationship's over. Pittsburgh! I already took all your picks, didn't I? I didn't! But they still have a ton of value, so that's not really going to work. The New York Rangers. I'm going to have to take somebody back. I think they were probably at the max contract limit. Everybody is. Zekov. I'll take Valentin Zekov for the rest of the year. And draft pick-wise, do we have anybody overly interesting? We can just do a whole bunch of that. Alright, what if I take that out? What if I take that out? Just give me two first rounders, man. Would you? Also, I don't know if you noticed, but I think our San Jose first round picks from Pool Party have finally run out. That's where it started. I'm pretty sure that was like the catalyst for this getting to be ridiculous, was getting all of those first round picks for Puljujarvi. I'm pretty sure that was the turning point, the major turning point for what we've been doing. So I need to wait for those players to accept. Thank you. And the roster, in terms of ridiculousness, is going to take a step back, but we're going to try to rely on a lot of our younger players to step up, lead the way. So Parsons, Zekov, and Cardwell are going down. You two get called up. And I'd still have to sign a couple of forwards to make that roster better. So what would this squad look like heading into this year? Just won the Cup with the Blue Jackets in year four. If you kept Bobrovsky and Panarin, it was cheating. So we'd send down Lachance, third line. Not bad. So Omelette does have the better shot. So Hart, McDavid, Omelette. Marlowe, Asham, and Voroviev. Third line of Kallio, Kuhlman, Holmstrom. Kuhlman would be center there. Fourth line, we'd have a chance with a couple of random free agent signings. It's not all that bad. And defensively, it's still just stacked. Dahlin, Makar, Andrychuk, Okpozo, Voros, and Sanlak. Not bad at all. And Wallstead's back. So if we continue on with this, which, to be honest, I might, because I kind of want to see how the likes of Hart and Roulette Wheel end up doing this year. If we continue on, the roster is in a good spot, right? It is in a pretty good spot. And if that's the end of it, well, we won three straight Stanley Cups and Edmonton's fixed.